Hello, everyone. Hope you're doing well. And I just wanted to chat a little bit. This is not going to be a real long video, but just wanted to talk a little bit about the course. And it's going to be a very informal video here as well. But I just want to talk a little bit about this course. I want to talk a little bit about church history, why I think it's important to study church history, why I think it's important to know a little bit about the past and where we came from, and then just talk a little bit about the reading this week and why I think it's, once again, it's just important, some things that we can come bring out of it. So I'm going to pull up here. Hold on just a second. The syllabus. Maybe I'm not. Maybe I should have done that before. Let me see if I can get it here. Hope you are doing well. I'm really excited about this class. I think it's going to be awesome. Here it is right here. And I really hope that you would just engage this material on some level. And so let's just talk through. A lot of you turned in, most of you turned in work. And if you haven't, you reached out to me. So thank you for doing that. I'm going to read it today and try to respond and give some feedback to you. But week one was last week, and you watched a video. I can't wait to read your thoughts on the video. I loved it and thought it was pretty informative on a lot of different reasons. And we're going to talk about that in just a little bit. Week two, just some reading and watching this video, doing some more work. We will do a Zoom session next, this week, actually, Monday night from 6:30 to 8:30, or to 8, just an hour and a half. And I promise it won't be longer than that. So we'll do a Zoom session, just answer questions. I want to try to respond to some of the questions that you have asked, and just talk about, have a group conversation, bring some more questions, and we'll just talk through some of that stuff and try to get some clarity and maybe on some of the stuff that you're reading and what you're looking at. Week four, once again, I'll do another video like this, just talking a little bit about some of the things that you're reading. Week five, you're going to be watching an amazing talk from an elderly lady who's now deceased, but Phyllis Tickle. It's unbelievable. And it kind of just brings a summation to all of the movements of church history and where we are, and really wraps up maybe some thoughts on what we should be thinking about moving forward and what does that look like for us. And then the last week we'll do another Zoom session, and it's probably going to be the easiest class that you take, I would think. Not because I'm teaching it, just because of the format. It really is just about trying to interact with where we have come from and where we have been. And so if you have any questions about any of those things, if you can't get on the videos, if you can't, I don't know, just let me know. And if you have questions throughout about some of the stuff that you need to do, like I said, it's pretty simple. A video and some reading, and then just some reflection on what you are interacting with, what you are learning. And like I said, and if you just do all the work, you're gonna pass this class. All right, so just do it. Like I said, I may respond with some questions for you to think about from your work, but it's not gonna be difficult. Just get the work done, all right? And we'll get beyond this. Because I think that when we interact with church history, a lot of it is learning, and I think that's important about what transpired. But I really think it's important for us that as we are looking at history in general, but also church history specifically, it's important for us to understand not just what happened, but why it happened, and start to grapple with why these things were taking place in the church, and what, because history, and specifically church history, it doesn't happen in a vacuum. And what I mean by that is it's not like the church is just making these decisions without bigger things happening in the world. And I feel like a lot of theology, a lot of our thinking about certain things that we find in the Bible, a lot of times comes out of culture And it's in a response to culture. And so they've shifted. And if we look at how theology and things have shifted throughout history, it is most often because of what's taking place in culture. And that sounds probably maybe heretical to some, but I promise you, I hope that what you're looking at in the Bible or in this book that we're reading is that it's so true that there's things that were happening in the culture and the greater society, and it caused church people to then say, this is what we need to do in response to these things. And sometimes it caused us to change some opinions or some thoughts based on how we were getting at the Bible and theology and all of that, those things. I think that we have to understand the Bible that way too. Just as a little side note for free, then we have to understand the Bible wasn't written or created in a vacuum. There were things happening that caused these people to write the things that they were writing and to give witness to the things that they were giving witness to. And when we understand that, it actually, I think, makes the Bible come more alive than if we just read it as the static story or bits of information. So church history, it didn't happen in a vacuum. And it's really important for us to understand that there were things happening in the world and in culture and in society that caused the church to respond in such a way, saying that we need to combat or push against or speak to these things that are happening. And sometimes when we do that and we react or respond, or things happen in culture, like big events, like you're going to hear about in the Phyllis Tickle talk. It's a funny last name, but you're going to hear about things that she says that every 500 years something happens in culture that causes the church to have to rethink and reimagine what it believes. And so I think that as we see those things, once again, thoughts and beliefs come out of it that that cause us to say, oh man, how do we handle this? How do we grapple with this? And some of those things, are like scientific. There's a scientific discovery that we have to grapple with. And unfortunately, most often the church pushes against those things because we want to hold on to our beliefs rather than saying, well, what does this mean about who God is? And how do we live and respond in light of the things that we are learning scientifically? And that we have to understand that I think scripture and science have to have this marriage. They're not these two separate things, but they're these things that work together. And so it's important for us that as we're reading and studying, that we see the movements and we understand the bigger picture and not just the specifics of what's taking place in each time period. That's why I don't think it's important. I think it's good to know, but it's not necessary all the time to know all of the dates and all of the people, but more, once again, the movements or what was happening in the culture at the time. And it's like I said, it's good to have a general idea about when they happen and what that looked like. But to have a church history class, and I had to do this. Like I said, I think it can be important. But for what we are working towards, I don't know that you should just be able to spew back dates and people and all of that. You should only be able to do that in reference to, once again, the bigger picture of what was going on. I don't know if that made any sense, but here we are. If it didn't, let me know. And so in the reading this week, once again, we get to Mr. Wesley, which is pretty significant for us. But I think that what I hope you pick up on this week in the reading is what was happening in theology and in culture and in the whole thing. And so it starts off with this understanding of the Enlightenment, right? The Enlightenment has happened. And like I said, we've come out of the Reformation. We've come out of this understanding, and the church is starting to splinter. It's starting to divide. It's starting to go have all these different branches because people are digging in, right? And they're setting some boundaries. And what I loved about the doc that you watched last week was how we're trying to bring that back around and have more unity rather than diversity and fighting. And so I think that that as you read the reading this week, something that I hope you start to pick up on is this is when Christian apologetics really started getting some grounding. And the reason it did is because the Enlightenment was happening in the world. And we moved from this kind of the world is a mystery, there are things that happen that we can't always understand, to this more scientific understanding of how the world works. And so the scientific method and Newton becomes really big. And we start to, in the world, say we can figure out how all of this works, how all of this is put together. And so there was a move in this time to saying science is what's really going to help us as a society, as a culture, as a people, get to the place that we want to get to, because we can know this and we can know this, and the world works like this, and this works into this, and it makes this happen. And so there was this big move in the world, in the greater world, to that we are in this enlightened people, and we're learning all this stuff, and we know how it all works. And so there then was this move in the Christian world because of all of this stuff. There was two things that happened. One was this group called Deist. And so they believed in God, but they didn't believe that God was active or working in our world. He was kind of somewhere far off. And he may have started this whole thing, but he was somewhere else. And the world was working the way the world works. The hard part about this, as you will read, is the thing where deism kind of failed, and this whole understanding of how that worked, that the question that those people couldn't answer was, then why do we have evil if the world is this place that is set and is supposed to work in such a way and supposed to truly have work in perfection, you might say, or work the way that it was meant to be, and that we can understand it and know it and get to a better, a higher good just based on the knowledge that we have. How do you explain evil and bad things happening? How do you have an answer for that? And they didn't have a good enough answer to why there's evil in the world, which I think should be a big deal to us, that we as Christians have to have a pretty good understanding and be able to describe in such a way that maybe doesn't bring comfort and is like, oh, that makes souls, or you know, that just makes me excited that there's evil in the world. But we have to have an answer for where we find ourselves and what that looks like, and what it means for us to be in the place where we are, where, as the Bible says, it rains on the just and the unjust. The sun shines on the evil people just like it does on some righteous people. And so it isn't just this, the world works like this, and you're just out of luck. But there's something happening that we believe that is outside of time and space that gives meaning and purpose and understanding to the things that we go in. Another thing that came out of this whole idea of we can know everything and everything has its place and this is the way it works, and science is the thing that's going to propel us, this enlightenment, right? Like, we just got to be enlightened, and Christianity doesn't have answers like this. And so what happened was, once again, this is where Christian apologetics really became a big deal. If science is going to be able to explain everything and have nice, neat little categories for all of life, then we need to do that as Christians, and we need to start saying this is what this is, this is what this is, this is what this is. And so we came up with these answers, you might say, that sometimes potentially were conversation enders, because if you didn't hold up to these understandings or this knowledge, if you didn't have these answers, or your answers were different than X, Y, and Z, or whatever the case may be, then you were just wrong, right? And you were not living or believing, that's a better word, you were not believing the things you needed to believe in order to be a Christian. And so our Christian faith became a matter of intellectual knowledge. You just have to know the right things. And if you know the right things and can spit out the right information, then you're good. But you have to understand that this came out of the Enlightenment and what was happening in the world. And so the two go hand in hand. This is what was taking place with science, with all the things. So the Christians, the church thought it needed to combat that by giving its own intellectual properties, intellectual understandings, and intellectual things. And what happened was, being a Christian was, you believed all of these things rather than allowing your life to live. A lot of people during this time, Blaise Pascal is talked about, and so he talks about this understanding of the mystery of who God is, that you can't understand it all. And so it's all in relation to, how do we live? What does it look like? How do we understand the Pascal mystery, you might say, was this set of propositions about what Jesus did, what it meant for us, and laying out, believe these things and you will be saved, and this is what it looks like for you to be a Christian. So he rejected a lot of the tradition that came before him. He rejected a lot of the experiences of the people, and it was all about, once again, just trying to chart down to the most concise thing that you can come up with in order to respond. And even in the church, there was this division of, do you believe a tradition and experience, or do you believe in this rational understanding of who you are and what that looks like? And then here comes John Wesley. I think this is, once again, why it's such a big deal for us, and why I love the Wesleyan, what's called the quadrilateral, right? We talked about that, but it's more of like a try thing, right? A stool that sets on scripture. But Wesley takes all of these things into consideration, that it's not just one or the other. And sometimes when you're making a decision, it's just two of them, or maybe three, or so he really tries to come at it from a holistic approach, that it's we don't reject tradition, and we don't reject reason, and we don't reject experience, but all three of those things have to rest on scripture, and what does scripture say about who we should be. And then Wesley really emphasizes that what the holy life is this lived journey of trying to love God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love our neighbor as ourselves. And it isn't just this intellectual ascension, that if I just learn all of this, that's a part of it, but it's only a part of it, as it causes us to experience who Jesus is calling us to be. And he would say, once again, that all rests on scripture. And we do need to look to the early fathers, and he was big on Akempis, right? And all of these people these early church fathers he would read. But it only made sense in the understanding of where we find ourselves and how do we apply who Jesus is and what he said through these people to our current situation. And so as you're reading this stuff, and then it goes on, and then we're going to keep moving on. Usually there's things that are happening in our history, things that are happening outside of the church, that if we are just honest, and we don't like to admit this, like, no, we're just about the Bible, and we're just about this, and we're just about this, but just, if you look at church history, I hope what it helps us to do is to help us to understand that the church is always responding to, always potentially shifting based on what is happening in the bigger society. Now, why do I think it's important for us to study church history? Why do I think it's important for us to study church history? Thanks for asking that question. This is why I think it's important. Because if we're not careful, we can make the same mistake where we find ourselves today. That we could so lean into one of the areas. We could so lean into one aspect of where we find ourselves. And we could be responding to something that would cause us to shift all of the things that we think the Bible actually says, but we need to respond to this thing. And so we're willing to shift and we not listen to this or that, or listen to this person but not that person. We're not willing to take it as a whole. And if we can learn anything from church history, as we study, as we read, the point that I think is the biggest point is that we don't want to shift our understanding of who Jesus is in such a dramatic way, just based on what is happening around us. But understand that in the middle of it all, Jesus was pretty constant about who he's calling us to be. Jesus was pretty constant about what it looks like to live in this kingdom of God. Jesus was pretty, pretty, there's a bass note, there's an underlying current that no matter what is happening in culture and what's coming here, there, and everywhere, no matter what's coming at us, there is this bass note that we have to listen to that we build everything else on. And we can't get rid of that and say, well, that's what it used to be, but now this is what it means to follow after Jesus. We have to keep the bass note the bass note. And so as we read church history and why I think it's important for us to have a general understanding and looking at what took place and looking at what happened and looking at how they decided what to do, is that we would then hopefully not make the same mistake. Hopefully not make the same mistake. But unfortunately, we're just repeating. And I have a whole lot of thoughts about what we're repeating and what it looks like. But it's just interesting, as you see what's happening in our culture today, as you see what's happening with those who call themselves evangelicals, the good news in our political system, we really haven't learned that much from church history. And so I think a pastor is someone who understands that there's been some ebbs and flows. Do I ever get up and say, hey, in 1517, this is what happened with Luther? No, but what I do say is, hey, this is what we are seeing in our midst. This has happened before. We have done this before. We have responded to things in such a way that we tend to take on more of the culture than allow Jesus to rise to the surface. And we have to be careful that we don't make the same mistake. And I just think that when history is written about the church, in 100 years from now, when people are reading about the year 2021 and the Christians, the church in America at this time, I think the people will potentially be looking back and saying, let's learn from their mistakes. I don't think they got it right. They sold their soul for power sometimes. They gave up their convictions because of what was taking place in their culture. And they actually did things that don't line up with who we think Jesus is because of what they thought and perceived they were to be doing in the world. And they were sold a bill of goods that if you do this, this, and this, and if you just get this person elected, and if you just make this happen, that's when God is going to act and respond. And I feel like we have not done well at keeping the bass note, that we are to love God with our heart, soul, mind, strength, and love our neighbor as ourselves. Like, that's what the law and the prophets was all about, loving God with everything that we are and loving our neighbor. And who is our neighbor? It's even a Samaritan, which would be the enemy, right? Even one who would be the half-breed, the one who everybody else looks at and would push aside and would walk around the city so they didn't have to go through Samaria, would take the extra time to walk around, like those places that you wouldn't go, those people that you wouldn't think about, and the people that maybe we look at and think, I would never do anything that would help, that would put me in a group with them. I never would want to be seen with them. I would never want people to see us in the same place. Jesus says, that's our neighbor. That's our neighbor. And whatever we do for them, we're doing for Jesus. And so I feel like we as Christians have, we haven't learned our lesson. And it's important for us to look at church history. It's important for us to understand the ebbs and the flows and decisions and like I said, not to know dates and people. It's important. But in the grand scheme of what it is we are trying to do is to see the arc of what was going on, what was happening in culture, how did the church respond? Did they respond with, let's do what they're doing so that we can match up and we can, or did they say, yeah, but we're still here just to be who God's called us to be in the midst of where we find ourselves. And so as you're reading this section and once again, coming out of the Reformation and all the things, and then you just see this church continue to splinter out and have more branches, it has more to do, once again, I think, with how they're responding to culture and what's taking place than it does to being true to who they think Jesus is actually calling them to be. It has more to do with having a foot in the culture and trying to respond to what's going on rather than saying, oh, that's cool, but Jesus is the same and he's calling us to be different in our place, in our community. And the way he's called us to be different is to reach out to those people who nobody else will, to love the unlovable, to love our enemy, to give a cup of water when nobody else will, to welcome the stranger, the foreigner, to take care of the widow, the orphan, to do the things that doesn't seem like everybody else is really, really excited about. That's the way God has chosen to bring his kingdom and to enter into our society through the church. And so that's why I think it's important. And so that's the lecture for today, I guess you might say. The reason, once again, we study church history is not to learn a bunch of dates and a bunch of people. It's not to learn that, but it's to see how has the church responded. Are there things that we believe today that had nothing to do with what Jesus talked about, but had everything to do with it, what was going on in a certain time, a certain location? So now we have this theology that we just claim is biblical truth, but it really isn't, because it has more to do with what was happening at that place at that time than it has to do with what the Bible actually says about that. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in our Zoom session next week, about things that theologies that arose out of cultural situations and circumstances, not from the Bible itself. And we read into the Bible what we wanted to read, but it wasn't actually what the Bible said about said things. I think it's a big deal. And so it's important, like I said. And so as you're reading, as you're writing, like I said, be thinking in what is the bigger picture here? What is the bigger picture? And are we, I think we are, but are we repeating mistakes maybe? Are we repeating movements that really have nothing to do with God's kingdom, but has more to do with we still want a voice, so we're willing to give up some things that Jesus thought was important, but we don't. So yeah, there you go. I hope you're doing well. Let me know if you have questions. And like I said, I know sometimes history can be boring, but I think if you look at the bigger picture, the bigger story, that's what I really want you to do. All right, it's what I really want you to be after. What's going on? Why did this happen? What was going on in this society and culture? Because like I said, that's the way we learn how to not repeat and not to do things that would bring about those same things. But we try to be more of who Jesus is calling us to be. All right. Hope you guys are doing well. Once again, let me know if you have questions, and I'll see you next Monday night at 6:30 p.m. on Zoom, and we'll get a link out by the end of the week or the weekend for that session. All right. Hope you're doing well. Talk to you later. Bye.